family land?
I'm not sure.
How you doing, sir? Curtis.
Michael.
It's me, sir.
they're going to go view.
He's just out here a second ago.
Right there, they're talking. Straight ahead. Okay. Sorry.
That's weird. That was a bummer. answer.
Why don't you hold the phone for Thomas? Who's he?
He's probably, he's listening. Oh, I see.
What's up, bro? We good, man.
I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me,
though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth in me shall never die. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still water. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you.
Well, good morning and welcome to the River of Life Christian Center of Orlando. My name is Kenneth Dentley. I am one of the associate ministers here, one of the pastors. And I'm here on behalf of our pastor, Pastors Marvin and Deborah Jackson. Our condolences go out to the family of the Pryors and all of the friends who came out to support them in this hour of bereavement. We're so glad to have you today, and we just hope that you just have a great experience today as we join in with the family to not only eulogize, but to commit our brother Tom to his resting place. Before I get started, I just want to say this to you in your hearing. As humans, it is inevitable that we feel loss and pain when a loved one passes from this life. But as Christian believers, our faith compels us to rejoice with them because their graduation to glory in the presence of Jesus. So whether you feel like shedding a tear or shouting hallelujah, go ahead. It's okay. It's appropriate. We invite that. We gather here together to celebrate the memory, the life, and the legacy, as well as the God of Brother Tom Pryor. So let us pray now. Father in heaven, we are so thankful to you and we welcome your presence here. And we ask you for your peace and your comfort to our hearts. Our prayers for everyone in this room, that it might be said of each of us when we pass from this life, as it has been said about Tom, that God had first place and first priority in our lives. And we thank you. Praise you in Jesus' name, and everyone's shouted amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Well, once again, my name is Kenneth Dentley, and I'm going to be facilitating here today and officiating over this homecoming celebration. And we want you to be comfortable here. I don't know whether you know it or not, but the River of Life Christian Center is a church that they've attended and they have been members of since they were here. And so we want you to know that we are here to accommodate you in any way we can. If you need to go to the restrooms just outside of the door, you can go to the to your left, and then the restrooms are on the right. We just like for you to just take the time and just familiarize yourself with the exits in case of any emergencies. Know where they are so that you can get out quick. And I'm saying that because we need to understand where we are, because some of you have never been here before, but we understand that you need to understand as well. And so before we go into any part of the service right now, we're going to go into our next part of the service. And I'm not reading this too well, so you know what to do. Brother Noel is going to come, and he's going to minister to us in song. Okay? I'll be back.
Hallelujah. Can we give our God a praise today? I know it's worthy. Hallelujah. Can we stand to our feet as we exalt this holy name and say, how great is our God?
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, and all the earth rejoiced, all the earth rejoiced. He wraps himself.
the Lord. How great is our God. Turn to your neighbor and say, we serve a great God. Yes, we do. We do. Our order of service will be as follows. Those of you who have an obituary, we can see those. We will have next the prayer of comfort, and that's by Minister Carmen Love from Chicago, Illinois, followed by the Old Testament reading of Psalm 46 by Julie Yett Howard Scott. New Testament reading will be by Nadine James, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 55 through 58. She's from Ellenwood, Georgia. And followed by that, we'll have another song by the praise team. Please come in that order.
Unshakable.
before time began. You are on your throne. You are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone. You are God alone. Before time began, you were on your throne.
Give me four. Give me Most of those years, Tom practiced law with me almost 2 decades. And I showed Tom love. And Tom showed me love. Habitually, consistently. But greater than that, Tom showed love to my wife, Wendy, and our kids, Jay and Chloe. And I love Marvel, Robert, Thomas, and Caroline just like they were my kids. And there's nothing that I can say to you that I haven't said to Tom a zillion times. Saying I love you was easy. One of the things that when I first met Tom, he was a fascinating man. My brother had died in 1998 in prison through medical murder. So I learned medicine and I filed a case against the state of Florida. And I would see Tom around the courthouse locally. And we became great, great friends. And when we first met, we used to talk about all kinds of things. And I said, Brother Tom, these are four foundational revelations that every person needs to know. Because I don't have a discussion with anyone that I don't really know if they don't understand these four things. And that's when we clicked. I said, number one, God created the devil so God can always destroy the devil. Number two, do you believe you create yourself? Number three, are you smarter than God? And I ask you to tell this to judges. Number four, and this is one of Tom's favorite things he got from me. What God created can be medically confirmed, scientifically affirmed, and archaeologically established. The thing about Tom is you can pin no Tom. We used to do the SHIA program for about 7 years. Him and Marvel was the leaders of that. And sometimes on Saturdays, when we would have to take our car and go to the bank and do certain things, Tom would volunteer to pick me up. We have to be there at 5 o'clock. So that meant Tom would come and get me at 4 o'clock. And Tom is the only person I ever met. When you agree to something, you don't got to follow up. I have to call Tom, say, Tom, are you out there? Gonna be here? We said the week before, Tom is there, 4 o'clock in the morning. He was loud. You can depend on it. Tom showed love. And this Bible that Thomas and Marvel gave it to me, we did a whole lot of Bible study and prayer daily. And a lot of people would tell you how the goodness of Tom, all that is true. But what really was amazing with Tom is the comedic Tom, the animated Tom, the Tom that storytells, the Tom that runs, that glides, that jumps. He can tell a story. And what was beautiful to me, I see Robert and Tom telling these stories the last week. And I'm just sitting back looking at them like, Everything God does is in seed multiplication. And there I see it. I can tell you a lot of things about Tom. But one thing about Tom is that he was generous. His goodness, you can't explain it. He'll help anybody. We used to give privately to all the homeless people, many of them know us, because I used to be a little bigger. And they used to see us from a distance. They go, Big Charles and Tom, because they know we was going to bless them really, really good. But anyway, I understand I'm going to be disciplined, because I can talk forever about my brother, but he was love and he showed love. And I'm so glad all of you came out to express your love for such a great man. And I know he loved Jesus. That's what makes me He was about two lockers away from me, and I had not known. He had just moved down from New York 6 months before I did, and I had just moved down from New York to Winter Park High School, and so we were both playing basketball together, and we remembered seeing each other at basketball, and we started a conversation in that hallway that began a friendship of 50 years. Later in the yearbook, I went back and looked at our old yearbook from 1978, graduation, and Tom wrote in there that that he was grateful for knowing my family over the years at that time, over those 3 years at that time, and he showed a lot of wit, and he said, he wrote actually that, and I forgot this, how long have you been asking me to sign this yearbook? 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, literally written out on this page I saved for him for weeks. And he goes, well, today's your lucky day, he wrote in there. And, yeah, he had a great sense of humor, but so did I, and we loved that about each other. And going back in the, I always said in the summer of 1976, we would ride bikes together to and from basketball practice all summer. And Tom, in 1976, Tom, I realized, was Google. He literally was Google in the summer of 1976. I could ask him anything about any subject, sports especially, or music. I love to talk to him about that. Or even Bugs Bunny. And Yosemite Sam, he was an expert on analyzing those cartoons. And it was just, I was just astounded by his intellect and his knowledge of every subject. And I want to say that over the years he would, he was so generous with me and my family. We were in each other's homes, and we got to know each other's family. It ended up where I coached his brother in Little League baseball with my father. Richie was on the team. And so we had a relationship that extended beyond me and Tom. And my dad loved running into his father at Denny's on 436. My dad, who I still remember, running from the car and leaving my mother in the car to go talk to Tom's dad at Denny's for like 20 minutes. And it was strange that we loved talking. And again, I could talk about Tom for 2 months, let alone 2 minutes. And I could talk him into senior skip day and running down to River Country with me and a bunch of people for the day. And he could talk me into an all-nighter Marx Brothers movie marathon down on Orange Avenue when I didn't want to go. And we had a blast doing that. Even at my high school graduation, I didn't want to go to my house and have my mom make a cake and have juice, but Tom talked me into it. And even in the pictures now, when I look back, you can see me frowning and Tom next to me with a big smile for the camera. You know, he was telling me, no, Rick, just go. Your mom made a cake, she made juice, you gotta go. I'm going, I don't want to do this. So, we were basically peas and carrots all through high school and college. He would come back from college over the summers and bring me back jerseys and hats from SMU in Texas. And I have so much clothing from him from Texas that people at UCF thought I was actually from Texas. They asked me, "But did you go to SMU or did you go to SMU?" And I said, "No, friend brings back hats and shirts." But I love that more than proudly. He's the first person who ever said to me the words MTV. I'd never heard of such a thing, and he's like coming by my record shop at the Orlando Fashion Square Mall, where I worked through college in 1983. He's going, oh, no, that's a video, and he's explaining videos to me, and I'm like, oh, I'm way behind, but Tom knew everything about it and introduced me to it and so forth. But we could talk forever, and I want to be thankful. Over the years, I remember visiting him in Jacksonville at the house. In Jacksonville, he's been to my house
many out of Largo, Glenwood, wherever we lived, we always would run into Mama, and Tom would always come over, and we'd have them over. And then this last year and a half, I got to see him many occasions, and they were so meaningful to bring up the old memories. And I'm not going to share them all because some are good. So, but that's high school and college. But Tom, I can summarize, is Tom was Jeopardy. He could answer questions on Jeopardy, and I was more Price is Right. That was my comfort zone. Yet we could get along. Me trying to make Tom laugh was like an all-ending 10-year experience for those years high school and college. I would sing to him even at the bus ramp, just an annoying song, just to get a, you know, get that one eyebrow up and so forth from Tom. And he'd just tell me I'm nonsense. It's a bunch of nonsense. But anyway, this last year and a half, being with Tom as recently as February at my house, and he came by, and Marvel, of course, and he wanted to see Spyro Gyra, the band that I remember, he loved their music, I always remember that. But we did a lot of concerts together, we did a lot of Super Bowls, we watched at his house a lot. And one last thing, it's just on the side, Tom made killing insects an Olympic event. If you were around him all day, he would just rise like a lion on the prairie when he spotted something crawling. And I go, what's going on? And he'd get the shoes out. And I love that about him. I mean, that's one of my favorite memories. It was like that. And again, we were with each other a lot for many years, and he was the most important friend I ever had. He was my best friend I ever had. And I've had a lot of good friends. But Tom was class. He always had dignity. My parents loved him. My wife loved him. My brother loved him. If you met Tom, you're gonna love him. Everything about him. So I want to thank you and the family again for letting me speak. Cards didn't really help this time, but we'll try another time. Thank you.
come once again to celebrate this man, this great and mighty man of God. I don't know about you, but I call him a prodigy. Has to be. Everyone talks about the wealth of information that this man can take. He's got to be a prodigy. He's got to be more than just a person who just completely studied, understand it. This is a special gift from God. And Marlon, you and your children, your family have a chance to just build from them. The wealth of information that he provided you guys with. I celebrate him. I never met him, but I celebrate him. And you should too. Can we give another hand to him? At this time, we will have obituary and slideshow, and we ask you to read silently while the song plays. Frank Sinatra song, I Did It My Way. Also, after you get the meeting, you can turn your attention to the screen there to see the slideshow. And after that, we'll have the resolutions and acknowledgement from the River of Life Christian Center, followed by a solo from Noel Willis. And after that, I will be back again to do the eulogy.
good afternoon, Caroline. Dad calling. Wishing you a Merry Christmas. Hope you had a good day. Hopefully, you have a nice time with your parents. So, just have a nice day. Just want to give you a quick call. Asleep. What part of the day? In fact, you really know that, but I wanted to call you before I went to the little map. So, take care and love you. Take care. Have a good day. Bye.
From the City of Orlando, Office of Mayor Buddy Dyer, to Mrs. Marva Howell Pryor. Dear Marva, on behalf of the City of Orlando, I would like to extend my sincere sympathy for the recent passing of your husband, Thomas Tom E. Pryor. My concern and compassion go out to you, your children, and grandbaby, and the rest of your community and extended family during this difficult time. Please know that our community is here for you throughout this time of transition. We hope that time and warm memories will lessen the pain of your sorrow, and you may draw some measure of comfort knowing that others share in your loss. If we can be of any assistance to you while you navigate this challenging period, please know that we are only a phone call away. Sincerely, Buddy Dyer, Mayor. Carter Tabernacle Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. Resolution of respect for Brother Thomas Pryor, Jr. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things have passed away. Revelation 21:4. Pastor Morris, ministerial staff, officers, and the Carter family are in prayer with the family of Brother Thomas Pryor, Jr. as we celebrate his homecoming. We are praying for comfort and the peace that passes all understanding during this difficult time. Whereas in the providence of God on Saturday, April 6th at 7:30 a.m., Brother Pryor received his travel itinerary and boarding pass, and our Lord and Savior dispatched his heavenly angels to escort him to his eternal home. Whereas Brother Pryor was an advocate for Carter and served the church with his legal expertise. In addition to his legal expertise, Brother Pryor was a prolific historian. He could hold you spellbound with his knowledge of dates and facts related to historical events. Resolved that he will be greeted by his parents and in-laws, Mr. Robert and Ms. Glossie Burns Howard, and other family members and friends when he enters the golden gates of his eternal home. Lastly, resolved that you hold on to the treasured memories and keep your faith in God, for his absence from the body means he is present with the Lord. Our time on earth is only temporary, for there is a better place prepared for each of us in heaven. Penned and prayerfully submitted by Ruth S. Settles, the 16th day of April, 2024, Reverend Dr. James T. Morris, Senior Pastor, Carter Tabernacle Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, and presiding elder of the Central Florida District. River of Life Christian Center, resolution. If I walk in the pathway of duty, if I work till the close of the day, I shall see the great King in his beauty. If for Christ I proclaim the glad story, if I seek for his sheep gone astray, I'm sure he will show me his glory. Here the dearest of ties we must sever, tears of sorrow or sin every day, but no sickness, no sighing forever. And if I have earnestly striven and have tried all his will to obey, to enhance all the rapture of heaven when I've gone the last mile of the way. Whereas the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein, and the righteousness from the God of our salvation. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Thus we come in thanksgiving to celebrate the homegoing of our beloved Thomas Pryor, who has found rest with Jesus. Be it resolved that he who is faithful in a very little thing is faithful also in much. Moreover, it is essentially required of stewards that a man should be found faithful, proving himself worthy of trust. We thank God for Thomas Pryor, who has been a faithful member for 7 years. To the family, always remember, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. We live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Reverend White Christian Center extends its sincere sympathy and will be fervently praying for and with you during this time of healing and awakening that you call. We commend you to Jesus, knowing that God is able. May God continue to bless and keep you, wrap your healing arms around each of you, and strengthen your faith and trust in Him. Be it final resolve that we, the River of Life Christian Center Church family, recommend to you Jesus, who is able to comfort, strengthen, and keep you in this hour forever. A copy of this resolution will be given to the family, humbly submitted, Pastor Marvin and Jackson, River of Life Christian Center family. Acknowledgements and family would like to thank everyone for the calls, the visits, cards, and prayers during this time of grief. Thank you.
But this is how God gave it to me, and that's how I'm going to give it to you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. After my visit to the home of the Pryors, my wife and I concluded that Tom Pryor is a man that I would love to have known and even become friends with. He's the kind of man well spoken of by his family and his friends. I saw the love and the passion that his family members had as I watched them talk about Tom. The sparkle in their eyes. I observed them speaking about him in such a passionate way. But I never met him in person. I would hear Marva talk about him a lot when she would come to the Experiencing God life group that we have online. And as I read the obituary and began to prepare the message, I thought to myself, I said, why would a man with such incredible gifts, talents, abilities, and skills, a man of learning and great education, with such a loving heart, be taken away from us so soon? And you know what? No one can answer that question except one. That's God. One of the things that the psalmist said in Psalm 31, verse 15, he says, my times are in his hands. I want everyone to say that with me. My times are in his hands. I don't know whether you have ever visited a graveyard or not, but in every graveyard, you have what they call a headstone. And in that headstone, you may see a person's name. You may see the person who submitted it by a beloved wife or a beloved husband. And then you see the date of the person's birth, their arrival here on the planet Earth. And then you see another date, which is the date that they cease to exist on planet Earth. And in between, there is a space bar, and that space bar, I call it a dash, is what I call time. Every one of us have an assignment. We've been given an assignment. We all came to this earth with an assignment. And in between the date of your birth and arrival here and the date of your death, guess what? There is an assignment, and God gives all of us time. You may not be scripturally literate as some others may be, but understand, folks, that it's in the Bible for you to check out, and I will give you references so that you can go in and see. Now, while the family spoke so candidly about Tom, I wrote down a few words to describe him. I said, he's exceptionally smart. He is sharp. He's learned. He's studious. He's intelligent. He has the ability to think things through. Now, I didn't get that on my own. I got that from listening to his wife. He has a forgiving heart, a giving spirit, an amazing generosity. He invests his life in others, even in his affliction. He looks out for others, even to the point of being vulnerable to them. Got that from you, Brother Charles. He's humorous, animated. That's Tony, this one. Very animated. When he shares his stories, he's always animated. He puts himself into it. Now, he loves to share his knowledge with others. We shared that, we heard that when they were doing the acknowledgments here. And he loves his wife, Martha. Now, you say, well, how do you? She said, my best honor ever was to take care of Tom. My best honor in life was to take care of Tom. Now, a wife wouldn't say that about her husband unless he was really good to her. And I believe, you saw the pictures. You heard what people said. You heard it. Some even acknowledged that he was good to his wife. He's good to his family. And that's a rare commodity sometimes these days. He loves his children, Robert, Caroline, and Thomas, but especially his grandchildren. I heard some of the things that they spoke about him with grandchildren, and I can just imagine, because I'm a grandfather myself, maybe I don't look like one, but I'm a grandfather myself, and I know how to love my little grandchildren. Amen. So those of you who are grandparents, you can say amen if you want to. Amen. Now, if you haven't noticed anything yet, I speak about him in the present tense and not in the past tense. You might ask the question, why? Please allow me to explain. Because he's not dead. Not to worry. He's not going to get up out of here if he is. You don't have to worry.
but he's alive and well. We speak about people in Christ that we know that died in Christ, that died in faith. Jesus told us some secrets, and I'm going to share them with you. But he's not here. He's in heaven with Jesus. And if he's in heaven with Jesus, the author of life, he is alive. And you ought to shout amen, somebody. He's not dead, he's alive. Now, Tom gave his life to the Lord Jesus Christ and placed his faith in him for the remission of sins. And because of that, he's in the presence of the Lord who forgave his sin and wrote his name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Turn to your neighbor and ask him, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Someone might say, well, I don't know, I haven't seen it. But let's explore this in more depth. In the book of Genesis, because somebody wants to understand, you know, why, how did death get into the world? How did this thing start? And I'm glad you asked that question because I want to help you. In Genesis chapter 2, verse number 7, the Bible says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the earth, that is his body, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, which is his spirit. And man became a living being, which is his soul. So we see that mankind is a triune being. He is spirit, he has a soul, and he lives in a physical body. What we see today, when you watch him in the casket laying there, you saw a man's body. You saw the house that he used to live in. He's moved out of that house. He don't live there anymore. So therefore, that actually is just where he used to live, but now he's no longer there. But he is somewhere else, and we'll discuss that in a minute. So the Bible says that God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, out of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. That's how death got into the world. The day that you eat of the fruit, the day, in other words, the day you disobey God, you die. So what happened? The Bible went on to explain. You can read it for yourself in Genesis chapter 2, Genesis chapter 3. You can find out when God made his wife, gave her wife Eve. The Bible says that God said to himself, it's not good that man should be alone. How many of you men know that is true? That is true. It's not good for a man to be alone. I don't know if some of you didn't raise your hand, but I'll raise my hand for you. Amen. It's not good for a man to be alone. I need my wife. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Said, women, you are a precious commodity. Amen. Thank you so much, Lord, for giving us a wife. But the Bible says when he made the wife, the serpent came to hit her and said to her, you know, hey, did God say that you guys can't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? And she said, God said, we shall not eat of it, neither shall we touch it, lest we die. Then the serpent did something deceitful. He told a lie. He said, you shall not surely die. But God knows that if he was to eat of the fruit, you will be like him, knowing good and evil and being wise. So the scripture went on to tell me, we'll just tell you a little part of the story here. The scripture went on to say that when she saw that it was good for food, pleasant to the eyes, a tree desired to make one wise, what did she do? She took and ate, turned to her husband with her, and he did eat. And that's when death came into the world. Now, women don't feel too bad. It wasn't your fault. It was the fault of the man, because the woman was not even made when God gave the man the command. So he screwed it up. Look at your husband. If you're married, if you look at your husband and say, you screwed it up. You guys, amen. I heard someone say, thank you, welcome. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now let's go from first fast forward into the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse number 7, number 12. It says, when Adam sinned, sin entered into the world. Adam's sin brought death. So death spread to everyone, for everyone's sin. Everyone. Everyone say everyone. Everyone. Yes. Adam's one sin brought condemnation for everyone, but Jesus' one act of righteousness brings a right relationship with God and new life for everyone. Because one person disobeyed God, many became sinners. But because one person obeyed God, many will be made righteous. Now understand this, and there's some lawyers in the house today, so understand this law. The law says, and this is God's law, in Romans chapter 6 and 23, he says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Now understand, the wages of sin, wages, that means that if you work for sin, guess what? your pain is death. At the end of the day, when you leave this life, if you work sin, if your work was sin, guess what's going to happen to you? You will die. And that word death has a broader meaning than just saying somebody who just lay in the coffin. Understand? The Bible lets us know that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. He went on to say, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. Jesus did not come to condemn us. He came to save us. He came to redeem us by his own death and burial and resurrection. That's what he did for you. He did it for me. So the Lord said, if you work sin, you die. Adam sinned the day that he disobeyed God. He died that very day. Someone said, well, he didn't die right then because he lived to be 900 and something years old. I think it was 930 years old. But understand, the Bible says the day, one day with God is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day. So Adam lived right under 1,000 years. So he did not live a complete day. Amen. Do y'all understand that? I know it sounds like a teaching, but it's a teaching ministry here. The River of Life is that our pastor is teaching. It's a teaching ministry. Amen. So let's understand death a little bit. The word death is basically a separation. It's a separation. Remember I told you about the spirit, the soul, and the body out of Genesis chapter 2 and verse number 7? The word death is separation. Now there's, first of all, a physical death. The physical death is when the spirit and the soul of the man departs from the body. And that's exactly what happened to him, Tom. His spirit and his soul separated from God, from his body rather, and he went to be with God. Okay? Because God is the author of spirits. The Bible says he's the father of spirits. So he's the one that created the spirit. Remember, he blew breath into the man, the inanimate object, or the dirt, or the dust that Adam was when he framed or fashioned him from the dust of the earth. And so when they both left, and then there's another type of death. The second type of death is a spiritual death. That's when you're separated from the life of God. Sinners are all separated from God. Understand, when you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, you are separated from God. Because remember, death came into the world. It separated us from God. So if you're outside of Christ, you don't know the Father. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come into the Father except but by me. Understand? So you're separated from God. And that's spiritual death. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 1, and you have he quickened who was dead and trespasses and sins. Notice, he quickened, he made you alive. That's what the word, the Greek word, that means quickened is, it makes to make alive. So when you were made alive in Christ, you came up from the grave. We sing a song around here. We sing it around Easter time. You called my name and I came out of the grave. For everyone that put their faith and their trust and their hope in Jesus, just as he sang a few minutes ago, guess what? You came out of your dead grave. Hallelujah. And then there's the eternal death. That's the third death. That's separation of the unbeliever in the lake of fire, which is the second death. The Bible talks about in the book of Revelation chapter 20, verse number 12 to 15. But I'm not going to go and quote that or go into it because I want to get right on into this word and so I can let you folks go. Saints don't die. They simply fall asleep in the Lord. Look at someone and say, saints don't die. They simply fall asleep in the Lord. Now I'm going to take you to John chapter 11, verse number 1. We're going to talk about Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, their brother. The Bible says in verse number 1, now there was a certain man who was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, of the town of Mary and her sister Martha, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sister said to him, saying, behold, he whom you love is sick. Jesus stayed where he was for 2 more days, and in the process of time, you know the story, Lazarus died. Now, one would ask the question, if that's your friend, the one you love, when you heard that he was sick, why didn't you come to see him? We've seen you heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. We've seen you do many things. Jesus, if he's your friend, if he's the one that you love so much, why did you let him go? Jesus said, the sickness is not unto death, but it's for the glory of God. Understand, folks. When you get to a place whereby you want God to be glorified more than you want your own desires, then you arrive at a place whereby here Jesus is from. Are you with me? You have a place where you are Jesus' friend. And not everybody who say, well, I know Jesus is his friend. Understand. Understand. Everybody's not a friend of God. I know we sing that song around sometimes. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Jesus does not call everyone friend. Amen. But he stayed where he was for two more days. And the Bible says, according to the scripture, Lazarus died. Now, according to Jesus, Lazarus did not die. He went to sleep. That's why I said saints don't die, they simply fall asleep. In John chapter 11, verse number 11, the Bible says these things he said. And after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I must go that I may wake him up. Then the disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well. However, Jesus spoke about his death, but they thought that he was speaking about taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Understand this. John chapter 11, verse number 17 says, so when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews who had joined the women around Mary and Martha to comfort them concerning their brother, that's what we're doing right now, we're gathering around Martha, and we're comforting the family. Amen. And the Bible says, now, when she heard that he was coming, she went out to him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Understand, folks, there are times in our lives when it seems like God is so far away. Lord, I pray. We prayed together. We held hands. We quoted the scriptures. We spoke the promises of God. We had prayer chains all around the world, different cities. We prayed and we prayed. We even fasted, turned down our place. What happened? How come he didn't live? How come he died? Have you ever been to a place where you ask those kind of questions? Okay, you don't have to raise your hand, but I know every one of us in here that have been touched by death, by a loved one in some way, we've asked the same questions. Why? I told you before, God said, my times are in his hands. My times are in his hands. I don't understand why, but God, I just pray that you be glorified out of what's going on. So where was God? God was the same place he was when his son Jesus was on that cross. Same place, in heaven, watching it all unfold. Nothing escapes his eyes. Nothing escaped his mind. Nothing escaped his will. He was right there, looking at it all. But I believe there was a special thing for this man. Like Stephen, I believe that when Jesus saw him, he said, I'm bringing my loved one home. He suffered long enough. I'm bringing him home. Come on home, Tom. Sent the angels with an angelic escort to bring him into the presence of his God. And God is glorified today. God is glorified today. Nobody's mad or angry with God because, well, I'm praying that nobody is angry or mad with God because somebody, some loved one was taken away. You know, my father died. I was explaining to Robert the other day when he was in the funeral home for me at his father for the first time since he passed away. I explained to him, I said, my dad passed away. I was standing right there holding his hand. Let him go, because God is the Father of spirits. The scripture says, all souls are mine. God made it. You did not make it. Even though that's daddy, even though that's brother, that's mother, that's son, whatever, you did not make them. God did. So he has the right to say when they're going to come into this world, and he certainly deserves the right to say when they're going to leave this world, and we have no say so about it. Amen. God is God. And he can do everything he desires to do. But he's good, and he's faithful, and he's just. Glory to God. Not only that, he's merciful as well. Let me continue in the story before we can go home. Amen. Now notice the Bible says here. Now Martha said to Jesus, if he hadn't been here, my brother wouldn't have died. If he hadn't been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But even now, whatever you ask of God, he will give it to you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said, well, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? No, that's what Jesus asked Martha. He said, do you believe this? And she said, yes, Lord, I believe that you are. love of Christ, the one who's to come into the world. I ask you a question. Do you believe this? Do you believe you will see him again? Do you believe that he will be raised up again? Jesus is the resurrection and the life. He is the first begotten from the dead. And I'm telling you, the Bible says he is the author of our salvation. And if he's the author, he's the finisher. He started it and he's going to finish it. The Bible says also that he who began a good work in me is faithful to complete it until the day he returns. So a day is going to come when he's going to return and he's going to bring Tom with him. Amen. Can y'all shout amen?
Amen.
So somebody ought to know that he's alive. He's alive. He's not dead. He's alive. In John chapter 5, verse 24, most assuredly, Jesus says, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life. Didn't say will have. He said he has it. In other words, it's already now everlasting. You don't wait to get to heaven to have everlasting life. You get it the day you accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and the Savior of your life. You pass from death to life. Amen. Notice he says he shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. More surely I say unto you, the hour is coming and now is when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the condemnation. The resurrection of condemnation. My question to you is, which resurrection will you partake in? Everyone's going to be dead. Oh, you think when they're dead, they're great, they dry up or whatever, they turn to ashes and dust, or when they cremate, take the ashes and scatter them into the sea, that's all. No, they're coming back. And they're going to stand in this physical body. And when they stand in this physical body, they will be judged in this physical body. You will be judged. But the question is, which judgment will you be attending? The judgment seat of Christ, where there will be rewards given for the works that you've done, or you will be judged because you rejected the only Son of God that God sent to save your life, so you won't have to spend it in eternal hell. This is the truth. This is the Bible. You say, well, I don't believe the Bible. Well, you got a problem, a bigger problem than I thought. Amen. Let's close. Paul writing to the church in Corinth. Listen to this. For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, that is, when we die and leave this earthly body, we have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in our present bodies, and we long to put on our heavenly bodies like new clothing. For we put on heavenly bodies, we will not be spirits without bodies. Notice, folks, while we live in these earthly bodies, we groan inside, whether it's because of sickness, pain, or whatever. We groan inside, but it's not that we want to die and get rid of these bodies that clothe us. Someone said earlier today, he said, I want to live. But now he's really living. Rather, we want to put on our new bodies so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by life. God himself has prepared this for us. And as a guarantee, and as a down payment, you know what I'm talking about. As a guarantee, as earnest, he has given us his Holy Spirit. Glory to God. You ought to shout right there. You want to know whether you're going to be raised up or not? Do you have the Holy Spirit? Do you have the Holy Spirit? Someone said, yeah, I got the Holy Spirit because I dance in church. That don't mean you have the Holy Spirit. That means you just felt good. Amen. You just got happy, as they used to say. Amen. Well, how do I know whether I got the Holy Ghost, preacher, or not? Well, number one is that when you have the Holy Spirit, you will bear the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. When God places Holy Spirit on the inside of you, you will begin to look different than what you look like now. You might have cursed. You might have drunk, smoked, commit fornication, sexual sins, all kinds of things like that. But let me tell you something. When the Holy Spirit comes on the inside of you, something different. He shifts things. He changes things. He breaks barriers. He loose chains. He binds the shackles and things like that. And you come out looking like God. Someone says it like this. You know, I looked at my hands and my hands look new. I don't know what all that. Nevertheless, the things you used to do with your hand, you don't do no more. You might have used your hand to spite somebody. But guess what? Now that you're in Christ, you use your hands to bless somebody. See, there's a transformation that comes across in your life. When the Holy Spirit comes on the inside of you, you don't look the same. You don't talk the same. You don't think the same. You don't act the same. You don't hang out with the same people you used to hang out with. Something comes over you and you're changed. You're transformed. You're regenerated to life. Now you're living in Christ. That's what happened to me. with me. Someone said, well, I'm a nice person. I don't care how nice you are. Outside of Christ, you are a sinner. And the only way that you can be saved is by coming into the ark of Christ. Notice the Bible says, so we are confident even though we know that as long as we live in these bodies, we are not at home with the Lord. For we live by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are confident fully that we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. So whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal is to please Him. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged. Each one will receive whatever we deserve for the good and bad that we have in our lives. Folks, this is the scripture. This is the word of God that never changes. This is the true eternal word of God. It is the truth. You may not believe it, but you will discover one day when you close your eyes for the last time that what that preacher was saying up there is true. We will not rush through, folks. Every one of us is not going to go that way. If Tom were to held on for a few more years, we don't know what it's going to be. But something spectacular is going to happen one day. We don't know where we're going to be, what you may be doing. Something is going to happen. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and 51, I think the sister read in the New Testament. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all, as all in Christ, sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. See, something's going to happen. The change that took place on the inside is going to take place on the outside. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And with this corruption have put on incorruption, and then mortality has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, beloved, hear this, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain for the Lord. When you live your life to please God, when you live your life in service to God, guess what? He said, don't. If you have a loved one that has passed and gone on that was in Christ, I'm not saying they were a member of the church. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about one who has given their lives to Christ. They became a new creature. Old things passed away and all things beyond them. You're going to stand and you're going to meet the Lord in the air. There's going to be a great reunion. Things will be going on in this world. People will be going on about their daily lives. And all of a sudden, the shofar, the heavenly shofar will be blown. And people will vanish and disappear off of this earth by the billions out of every country, every state, every city, every province. All races, all creeds, all nationalities. People all over this world are going to disappear off this planet. And when that happens, chaos. What happened to my loved ones? So while you're listening to my voice today, understand, we who are in Christ, we're going to be with Tom, with Christ in the air. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for this word that changes the hearts of people. There's some here today that may have not heard this message before, but I thank you for the time that you've given me to explain these things. Lord, as I said to the people before, they all understood. We're here to comfort those that are. We are here, Lord, to continue to tell the saints of God to continue in the journey because you're so good. And be steadfast in the group. Always in the group. And we're also here to warn you, who are not in Christ, that the day is coming when the trumpet will sound. The day is coming when they will, their name will be called, and they too will go by way of the grave. But we're here, Lord, to throw out the lifeline. To throw out the lifeline so that we can rescue some from the grips of death, the sting, the pain of death. So we ask you, O God of compassion, when we feel helpless, I pray in our grief that you will hold us in your heart
Oh God of gentleness, in those moments when our lives are dark, we ask you to keep us close to you, God of comfort. When we're overcome with sadness, we ask you, Lord, to shelter us under your wings. You are the ever-faithful God. We ask you to help us to find assurance and hope that these words will hold to all the people of the world. Because you're so precious to us, and we're so precious to you. And because we are precious to you, and because you love us, we don't need to be afraid. We just pray, oh God, for the Pryor family. We pray for their friends. We pray for their loved ones. We pray for those who are here today. Come tomorrow. We're going home to the transition time. We pray, Lord, that something was said today that was strengthened their hearts. We thank you so much for your love and your mercy, your divine grace that you will impute unto them. So as they go back to their homes, Lord, they go back, they won't go back with such a heavy heart because they know that he's alive. And though they can't see, though they can't touch him or embrace him, they know that he's with you, Jesus. And you know how to take good care of him where he is until you come and get us all. And then we'll be one happy family around the throne of God, praising, worshiping, and thanking you for saving us and for redeeming us by your precious blood. Thank you so much. We give you praise. We give you glory. And we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen. One thing I forgot to say while I was in the message. He was very generous. He was so generous. He left mints. I got mine. This man was exceptionally generous. Big jar of mints. I helped myself to him. And I ate some mints and I couldn't eat one again. This is my memory of Tom. This is my memory of him. So right now, we're going to turn it over to the hands of Mitchell's funeral home. And we thank you so much for your time and listening to this message. We pray that you will take it to heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We will do the formal benediction at the graveside.